What's going on, YouTube? Metal Complex here, and welcome to my Saturday series, The Quest for the Perfect Budget Knife. Depending on how the week went, you guys might be viewing this on Sunday. I don't know. This is pre-recorded, and we're closing in on 5,000 subscribers at the time of this video, so I've got other stuff that's pre-recorded and set to go up. Blah, blah, blah. It doesn't matter. Whether you're viewing this on Saturday or Sunday, if you are unfamiliar with my channel or this series, I like to upload knife content every single day on this channel. I like to do knife reviews, knife overviews, I like to do unboxings, I like to do discussion topics. I have this Saturday series, or what's supposed to be a Saturday series, The Quest for the Perfect Budget Knife, and I have a Sunday series called The Knife Guy, where it's just general conversation and topics that we can all relate to. So if that sounds good to you and you like the idea of regular content, please feel free to subscribe to my channel because there's lots more coming. If you did not catch last week's episode, here is the episode list. There'll be 9 parts to this series. Last week we talked about overall size and blade length. Now, keep in mind, I'm doing this series based on my idea of an ideal budget knife. How do I define budget knife? Well, for the sake of keeping our options open, it's anything under $100, but we'll probably have to get all the way through the series before I can really explain everything or before you can see the whole picture. Today, we're going to be talking about what I consider to be the ideal handle materials, things like the hardware and pivot and stuff like that. We're going to talk all about that. Now, the idea of this series is not to convince everybody to think exactly like me. You can take these ideas and apply them to your own personal ideas of what is ideal for a budget knife. I don't want anybody to think that what I say is like, this is how it has to be, this is what I think is perfect, and you have to think exactly like me. No, you don't. Not at all. I just want to give my ideas on what I look for and what I think might be ideal, considering what I assume goes into the manufacturing of these types of things and the money that goes into it and what they end up costing at the end of it. So I hope that's clear as mud. Let's go ahead and proceed here. So I have a bunch of knives laid out. Some of them are inexpensive, some of them are expensive. Let's talk about titanium. Titanium is a very popular handle material for knives that are not budget knives. It's lightweight, nice and strong. It's very popular right now. Probably not a good choice for a budget knife because that right there is going to make it extremely, substantially more expensive than a knife that's made with steel or plastic or something like that. I was going to use the Best Deck Bison as an example. It's an oddball of a knife, being a titanium frame lock with G10, made in China and D2 steel. The knife still runs $110, which is far over the top peak of what I would consider to be a budget knife. So even if you were to make just a regular old D2 Chinese flipper with a titanium frame lock right there, just right there, it's gonna miss the mark. So titanium's obviously not gonna be an ideal choice. Aluminum, we see aluminum on a lot of knives under $100. The problem with aluminum is not everybody likes the feel of it. I mean, aluminum seems to be universally less accepted than materials like carbon fiber, G10, micarta, and titanium. I don't have a problem with aluminum. Me personally, I don't know that I would want it on my ideal folding knife, and I think mainly because it wears in a way that's not visually ideal to a lot of people. It's plenty durable and it'll serve just fine. It also gets really, really cold and really, really hot in different environments. And if you want it to be textured, it can be, and it can be smooth. I don't know. Aluminum is not something that I think a lot of people would prefer. I don't think it would appeal to the largest group of people. And that's the idea here, is I'm trying to hypothetically create a folding knife that is something that I would like, but something that I think would appeal to the broadest range of people. Obviously, there is no such thing as one folding knife that can do everything or appeal to everybody. That's not the point of this. You know, there always seems to be somebody in the comment section that's like, you're never gonna find the perfect folding knife because not one pocket knife can do everything. I know that. We know that. You're not educating anybody. This is just hypothetically, right? The broadest range of people. Carbon fiber. Carbon fiber strong. Carbon fiber is generally something that people like the looks of. It can be textured. It can be contoured, right? Carbon fiber is expensive. More expensive than materials like G10 and micarta and plastic, surely. So while you do see it sometimes, and more so you see laminate carbon fiber, meaning there's a little strip or a sticker on top of G10. That's fine. I mean, the Is it Civivi? Stratera? Yeah, Civivi Stratera is a budget knife, $75, D2, flipper, bearings, has a carbon fiber laminate on it. Looks good, but if I'm trying to make everything ideal, you know, in my mind, and keep the cost down as far as possible, which, you know, of course, price is on the episode list, but of course, it's going to be the very last episode, the very last thing we talk about. If I'm trying to keep the cost down, I don't think carbon fiber is going to be the way to go. We're trying to create the ideal budget knife with the user in mind. If you remember my quest for the perfect folding knife series, whether or not it was ideal in terms of utility, that was there, but not 100% the factor, and also price was completely out the window. We're making a hypothetical ideal budget knife that fits into a wide mass majority budget range, a lot of people's budget, and fits a lot of people's usage habits, and is actually going to be functional, right? So we don't need to put an emphasis necessarily on aesthetics. Well, plastic or FRM, a lot of people don't mind this, a lot of people like the Delica. The Real Steel Control, I can find this knife for $35 right now, and I think most people, I mean, as far as what it costs to manufacture these and put these type of knives together, does plastic cost more than G10? I don't know. But for the most part, G10 is a material that a lot of people consider to be more premium than FRN and plastic. In terms of what they are functionally capable of, they're probably about the same. In fact, I have that video where I physically try to break both plastic and G10, and they both seem to be plenty strong. I just have a feeling that more people prefer G10. Plus, it's easier to have modular scales made. It's easier to have custom scales made. We'll talk about that in modularity, which is going to be in episode 8. But for me, it's going to be a no on plastic. I don't like to see plastic on budget knives, and I don't like to see them on premium knives. I just don't like it. So for me, that's going to be a no. For you, it might be a yes. You don't have to agree with me. Steel. This is actually a steel frame lock, right? Couldn't cost that much to make an entire knife out of steel, and it'd be super strong, super tough. Steel, taking up the same dimensions as titanium. Titanium has an incredible strength to weight ratio, technically it does corrode. Titanium does. This isn't titanium, this is steel. Titanium technically does corrode, but it would take it. You're not going to corrode a titanium frame lock during normal usage. Steel will corrode, but it's extremely strong. The downside is it's heavy. This knife, the Real Steel Control, just having one side in steel and the other side in solid G10, it ends up weighing something like 6.5 ounces. Let me weigh it. Move this out of the way. Let's find out what this thing weighs. We did a review on it. Oh! 6.7 ounces. Can you imagine that thing at all steel? I mean, that's a pretty big knife. So let's say we shrink it down a little bit, right? We talked about overall size. My ideal overall size actually comes in two different sizes, somewhere between 8 to 8.25, if you watched last week's episode, and 6.75 to 7.25. All steel, even at those smallest dimensions and even thinned up, is going to be too heavy for most people, right? I don't know why I'm going over this so much. Most of you are like, we don't want a full steel budget knife. Truthfully, what I think is gonna make the most ideal handle material is gonna be G10. G10 is a fantastic material. It's gonna resist heat and cold. It can be molded into a bunch of different shapes. Most people like how it feels when it is smooth and contoured. A lot of people still like how it feels when it's heavily textured. Peel ply texturing such as this. They like kind of the rock pattern or wavy pattern. I mean, you know, there's a lot of stuff you can do with G10. And G10 is acceptable on budget knives. It's acceptable on production knives. You even see it on ultra high-end custom knives, right? Micarta would be good too. A lot of you are like, what about micarta? What about wood? You could, but again, you're not appealing. I mean, micarta appeals to a wide range of people, and I suppose it wouldn't be a bad material. I think it would be a good secondary material that could be offered as a modular type of scale for the same knife, but I think it would be a good idea just considering what things cost, or what I assume things cost from a manufacturing standpoint, and how easy it is to do that, and how widely accepted it is. I think G10 is a good idea for Miratiro. I don't know why it took me 10 minutes to say that. You guys probably could have guessed. G10 would be my choice for a budget knife, right? You see it all the way down on, what's the cheapest knife I have in actual G10? Where are you? There you are. The Ozark Trail flip knife. $5. This is G10, right? Does that mean you guys are getting ripped off? I don't know. My point is that, or not you guys, all of us. My point is that it couldn't cost them a whole lot from a manufacturing standpoint, which leaves money freed up in the manufacturing process to get some of the other details that I would want correct on this list. So G10 is what I would pick. That's what I want. Comes in a wide variety of different colors, blah, blah, blah. So next up, let's talk about hardware. I want to talk about something that you guys hear me complain about a lot. Little teeny tiny screws. I do not like this size. I don't like it at all because, and not everybody has this problem, the tools that you're fitting in there, it's so much easier to bend the teeth out on that little tiny T6 torque size. It's so much easier to strip out the screw. This knife, almost inevitably, this hypothetical budget knife that we're trying to create, will be made in China, right? It probably will also come, like most, a lot of budget knives, it probably will come with a limited warranty. I don't want to have to mess around and fight to get replacement hardware, or have to go to a third-party knife hardware online website and get hardware that, you know, fits the threads and is looks. I don't want to mess with it. Let's just use a larger size. Let me give you an example of two knives that have done their hardware correctly. The Spyderco Shaman, nice large. What is that? A T8, T10, and then probably T8 on the handle. Perfect. Perfect. This is so easy to take apart. And the setup here, by the way, we don't need this. I don't need a pivot and 5 standoffs. I mean, one of these is a stop pin. You have 1, 2, 3, 4 standoffs. We don't need that. You can do 2 standoffs or a backspacer. I kind of like the idea of a backspacer. Honestly, in terms of hardware for the back, you could do 3 standoffs at max and have 3 screws, right? Or you could do 2 and do a backspacer. Let's minimalize the amount of hardware that's on the knife. Less hardware is going to cost less money from a manufacturing standpoint. And let's make the sizes big enough to where we don't have to worry about the screws stripping out, or the hardware stripping out. Now, obviously, there's a lot more that goes into it. I am not a knife maker. I have never even witnessed knives like this being manufactured. You know, I don't know. You guys are getting information from somebody who probably doesn't know 100% of all the details. But in terms of the simple stuff, that makes sense to me, right? Less materials costs less money. These dome head or flat head screws are fine. Spyderco uses them on their knives. It's really easy. Here's another thing that should happen. Now, all of you guys know who have taken apart a Benchmade Griptilian. This is the Ritter, the Doug Ritter version. We all know what the inside of this pivot looks like, right? It's perfect. You've got a nice large Torx head. This pivot barrel is D-shaped. Why is that important? It's so it doesn't free spin. There's nothing more frustrating. ZT0562 fans, you know, taking your knife apart and you turn in and it's rotating. That sucks. Nobody wants to mess with that, right? So we do a simple D-shaped pivot barrel. D-shaped so it fits the frame, and that way while you're turning the pivot can rotate and come out, and this side doesn't rotate. It's easy. It's not going to get stuck, even if you have Loctite in there. Another reason why maybe doing standoffs wouldn't be ideal. Now, a lot of knives with standoffs don't have this issue. You can unscrew one side and unscrew the other. But sometimes you have a situation where you unscrew one side and this screw going into the standoff, unless it's lipped and the lips are D-shaped, it will also rotate. Now, making all of those little things D-shaped is going to cost more money from a manufacturing standpoint. Those of you who own the Spyderco Shaman, how easy is this thing to take apart? Seriously, 1, 2, 3, 4, and the pivot, and you're out. It's easy. This has the bushing setup, but you combine this D-shaped pivot setup that you've got on the Benchmade Griptilian or the Ritter Hogue, and the setup here, we have a very simple backspacer, and we've got 2 large torque size screws. And I'm sorry if I'm not getting the torque size correct. You guys probably know exactly what I'm talking about there. They screw directly into the backspacer and a lot of, well, what happens if the backspacer threads strip out? I talked with a lead guy at Quest Custom Knives, and he said, that happening, steel on steel, titanium on titanium, or steel on titanium, or vice versa, it's so rare that that happens. Really, what matters is that you get at least four threads into it. I would imagine in a situation, you know, looking at the Spyderco Shaman, four threads from either side going directly into a backspacer, or even setting up like a Chicago screw situation like what you have with the Rick Hinder XM18. I don't know if that would cost more money from a manufacturing standpoint, but those are all ways to cut costs on materials and make sure that there's nothing free spinning and it's easy to take apart. If this is going to be a user, it needs to be easy to take apart and maintain. These are all ways that we can achieve this. And this is no secret. I'm not telling anybody anything new. That's just how it should be. Minimize the amount of parts, make them easy to access. Don't do anything weird, no proprietary hardware. Don't try to make things flathead or Phillips head. Torx. Make it all Torx, make it all big, minimize the parts. And you know, you can do a backspacer situation there to keep it semi-open body and easy to clean out, but still absolutely durable in terms of what's supporting these two sandwich pieces here. Absolutely, 100%. How about the liners? Do we do countersunk? Do we do steel liners? So a lot of these companies, these budget companies, are doing countersunk liners. Countersunk, I mean, you can see on the inside here, the liners on this Hogritter, they're like cartridge style. Or on the Spyderco Shaman, you can see they are countersunk. They're set into the G10. Now that allows for the design to be lighter weight and still maintain strength. I do not want solid G10. I think a liner setup is the way to go. Unfortunately, this is the only setup that I can use as this example. And let me give my case for doing a liner setup that comes out to the lips. Now this knife weighs way too much and it's not a good example, but you can see here the liners are milled and the steel comes all the way out to the lips, right? A lot of knives have that setup. If you do that, you can offer some minimal weight reduction by milling out the inside of the liners. I think from a manufacturing standpoint, it is easier to create liners that sit directly under the shape of the G10. It's probably more expensive to cut liners that fit perfectly into a G10 scale. And remember, we're trying to create a budget knife here. So while this might be a better design, I think it'll be less expensive to go this route to keep those costs down. And at the same time, these aftermarket developers, people who want to make their own scales, it's going to be much easier to just make a scale to fit that liner than it is to make a scale and then carve out the inside and make it fit that, you know. And really, it's not so much the aftermarket, but you know, when we start to talk about modularity and the importance of modularity on that eighth episode, look at Rick Hinder, look at the Benchmade Griptilian. They are finally making these. I mean, the Benchmade Griptilian has the cartridge liner setup, but Rick Hinder has a setup where he's got a small liner sitting underneath, and then he's selling the crap out of those G10 scales. The aftermarket can't even keep up with him, right? He's the king of modularity. It's working. You can argue all day, but Benchmade set up their custom part of their website because so many people like to have their own thing, right? They want their own version of what they consider to be the perfect knife. A lot of people love the Griptilian. A lot of people love the Hinder XM18 3.5 inch. So Benchmade and Rick Hinder capitalized on the idea of controlling their own aftermarket and custom parts, and it's successful. So companies looking to create this budget knife, set it up like that. Yeah, it might weigh a little bit more than, you know, you're looking at an 8.25 inch knife with full steel liners that have been milled out and G10 on top of it. Honestly, you're probably looking about five and a quarter ounces on the big guy. But on the little guys, the ones that are 6.75 to 7.25, remember I said I think these need to come in two sizes, you're probably looking at a lighter weight. One that's probably, considering what popular budget knives are out there right now, right, the knife that I'm kind of building this series on, the knife that has reigned supreme for so long, this knife weighs like 5 ounces. Let's go ahead and weigh it. People like to complain about weight all the time, but nobody ever discredits the utility of the Rat. Yeah, 5 ounces. So there you go. And it's got the full steel setup with nothing milled out on the inside. So, I mean, that's my case for that setup. Sorry, I had to cut the video there for time, but yeah, that's my case for that setup, is that it's not going to be ideal in terms of aesthetics and it's not going to make everybody happy, but coming from a manufacturing standpoint and setting yourself up for modularity or ease of modularity, whether or not you want sales of the knife to be supported by there being an enormous aftermarket. I mean, a lot of that comes down to the handle shape and how easy that is. But I just think, I mean, this is a setup that's acceptable. Steel liners coming all the way out to the outside, right? And then G10 on top of that. You can control the thickness of the liners and the thickness of the scales, but here's a knife that's really popular, that's got scales on top, liners underneath, right? And it's very durable, and it's a $40 knife, and people like it, you know? We don't need to fix what isn't broken. I mean, obviously there's always room for innovation and new designs, and I think we should support that. But if I were trying to design my ideal budget knife, this is the kind of stuff that I would think about. Again, not everybody, you guys do not have to agree with me. You don't have to think exactly like me. And I'm getting all excited about this because I'm excited about it. But I don't want anybody to think that it's like, I'm right, nobody else can be right. You have to think exactly like me to be right, and your ideas don't matter. No, that's not true. I don't think like that at all. This is just how I would think. So moving on to the pocket clip, one of the best things I think, again, using the rat to build off of, one of the best things I think they did was just not try to do anything crazy with the pocket clip. The only flaw on this is where it's positioned, right? I mean, this looks like a typical Benchmade pocket clip. We have two knives that aren't actually Benchmade knives, but the Doug Ritter clip looks very similar and is positioned very similarly to the Benchmade Griptilian Deep Carry clip, which that clip and this clip I think are two of the best clips out there. But I also like Benchmade Standard clip, which looks a lot like this. It actually, I found out, it's not actually the same screw and thread size, so they're not modular, but a simple pocket clip. I mean, this is so easy in and out of the pocket. It doesn't have to be mega flashy, but this is wide enough. It's made out of steel. There's plenty of retention. There's a nice dip for you to grab. This doesn't stick up so far that I worry about it grabbing on things. This design is okay too, right? You could go deep carry, you could go like this, or you could follow in Benchmade's footsteps and just drill it to accept multiple different types. Don't make it so unique that you can't recreate, or make it so difficult for the aftermarket to create these parts. Sometimes, like, I look at knives and I'm like, well, what are the aftermarket parts like for this knife? And then whether or not I'll buy it, a lot of it weighs on like how many parts are available for it. Like, sometimes I'll look at a knife and be like, that would be great if I could customize it. And then I'm like, I wonder how many custom parts are available for it. I look it up and there's nothing. And I'm like, well, I don't like how it comes stock. I don't even know if I want it now. Sometimes, you know, and I don't know exactly who I'm speaking to right now. I guess I'm speaking to any companies looking to create a line of budget knives. Like, there's a whole bunch of them sitting there taking notes. Probably not, but you know what I mean, right? Sometimes it's nice to see that there's an aftermarket supporting this. So I'll buy a knife and be like, wow. Now, ideally, there would be enough, you'd have enough money that you could put into this to where you could create your own line of aftermarket parts. The idea is, keep it simple. If you're gonna do a pocket clip on the outside, something like this, symmetrical, that's gonna appeal to a lot of people. Make some in black, make some in satin, three screws. It's gonna hold it on there just fine. Something with a divot, something with a dip like this. Don't go straight, don't go ultra skinny, don't go ultra fat. Something like this is just fine. Don't make your lanyard, if you have to have a lanyard hole and you have a handle that it's this wide, you know, listen to the issues that people had with the pair of threes upstairs. The pair of three is a great example of how not to do that. Don't make excess room for the lanyard hole and move the pocket clip way down. People universally want as little of their knife as possible showing. If you're gonna do a pocket clip like this that's not deep carry, just move it up and either move the lanyard hole somewhere else or don't have it, right? I mean, honestly, this isn't even bad. How Spyderco's got that set up. Pocket clip like this is just about perfect, right? It's deep carry, but it's not super deep carry. It's nice and strong, it's the nice width. This is one of my favorite pocket clips ever. The only problem is that the screws are not recessed, so it's a little hard to get the seam of your pants up over those screws. So if you're gonna do that, recess the screws. If you're gonna do something like this, you don't have to recess the screws, but those should be both inexpensive little designs there. I don't know that there's a whole lot more that I can cover, but any pomp or frills that go into this, in my opinion, I mean, you know, this is different from my quest for the Perfect Folding Knife series, where I get into the fine, enjoyable details of the aesthetics. You know, a lot of those details cost extra money from a manufacturing standpoint. So minimalizing that stuff and just making everything about function first, right, and form second, is probably going to be better. I think this goes without saying Now, I know this is going to make a lot of people mad. And we're not going to talk about deployment today, but I want to talk about what's inside the pivot. This is a Kaiser Vanguard knife, the XL sheepdog. And this isn't really a great example, but it's running on bearings, right? This is a $200 PMP Revenge. It's running on bearings. This is a $35 or $40 steel wheel control running on bearings. Everybody loves flippers with bearings, and that's great. They deploy really well. My Excalibur, even my Hinder XM18 3.5-inch non-flipper triway, is running on bearings. I love the feeling of bearings, right? But when it comes down to actual use, most people know bearings are not ideal because gunk can get in there. If you're gonna really be getting into the dirt and getting into the gunk with stuff like this, you're gonna be digging in and there's adhesive from boxes, or there's, you know, flakes and chunks of, you know, sawdust or cardboard or little pieces of rubber or anything that can slow things down. You want everything sealed together, right? You could use nylon. Most people don't like nylon. To me, it's obvious. Phosphor bronze. This rat runs on phosphor bronze washers. I don't know if we can see in there, if you guys can actually see. See those bronze washers in there? Just hold the flashlight right there. Yeah, phosphor bronze. I have never had to take that thing apart. And I don't know if you guys can tell, but I use that. I've had to resharpen it twice. It's absolutely gets gunked up. Phosphor bronze washers are self-lubricating. This thing is still plenty smooth. Despite being a budget knife, it deploys just fine. I don't need it to have like the craziest drop shut action. It'll even deploy with my reverse finger. If I get the meat of my finger up under there and give it a little bit of a wrist, it'll deploy that way. But it'll still deploy this way just fine. Phosphor bronze washers, that's my vote. So to recap, liners should be milled out and steel, in my opinion, to make it easy from a manufacturing standpoint and still account for weight reduction. You're gonna need that on a setup like that. Simple G10 scale can be textured and colored however you want. Large size Torx bit hardware, D-shaped pivot. You can do a standoff design. A backspacer design is nice and strong, and it minimalizes the need for the amount of hardware. And of course, that's important. We want less hardware. We want a simple pocket clip design. Something like this is going to be inexpensive but strong, and it's going to be symmetrical, appeal to a wide range of people. And then what was the thing that we just talked about? Oh yeah, phosphor bronze washers. I know how much you guys like bearings in your budget knives, but if I'm coming at this from a user perspective, I'm not saying bearings won't function in a user environment. I'm saying in terms of the massive amount of people using folding knives for different things. You know, you guys have heard me talk about the 20% common man, or I'm sorry, the 80% of us who are the common man or common women. And then there's the 20% using their knives for way crazier, way harder stuff, right? Phosphor bronze is going to work out better for everybody, right? It's acceptable by people who just prefer the nice fidgety action of bearings, but it's functional enough to where they're going to enjoy it. The enjoyment of using it is going to make up for the lack of enjoyment of fidgeting with it. And then for people who are really using their knives hard, they're going to tell you every single time, phosphor bronze, that's what I want in there. I don't know that there's a whole lot more that I can talk about in terms of materials there, in terms of handle materials. I know a lot of you are waiting, like, what about blade steel? That's a material. Blade steel is going to be episode 7. So we're already kind of closing in on a 30-minute episode, guys. But I think that's going to be pretty much it. I think I covered everything the way that I wanted to. So if you enjoyed this episode of the Quest for the Perfect Budget Knife, please leave a like. If you'd like to check out my other content, I do, of course, have lots of videos of knives that are either expensive or inexpensive that I do or don't like. So check those out. And if you enjoy all my content, then click on that Metal Complex logo and subscribe to my channel, because there's definitely more coming. Thanks again for watching, and have a great day.